Good morning. Welcome again to Morning Devotions. I'm Pastor Sumrall, the pastor of the Cathedral of Praise. And Sister Bev has already warned me, Ezekiel is a really long one today, so I'm going to try to be as brief as possible. Open your Bibles, please, to Psalms 123, beginning with verse 1, and let me read it to you from the New Living Translation today. I lift my eyes to you, O God, enthroned in heaven. We keep looking to the Lord our God for his mercy. Just as servants keep their eyes on their master, as a slave girl watches her mistress for the slightest signal, have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy. Beloved, the longer I live, the more I understand the cry of the heart for mercy. You know, when you're young, you're a little arrogant because you think you're so good. But the older you get, the more you get some humility. And you begin to realize, Lord, I keep looking to you for mercy. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy. For we have had our fill of contempt. We've had more than our fill of the scoffing of the proud and the contempt of the arrogant. Beloved, every one of us in life, now, not as much here in our beloved land, but other nations probably face it worse. But, you know, as more and more Western influence comes into our country, we're seeing no respect. People have no respect. And they just show contempt for everybody. As if, you know, I looked at a young man one day, and he had shot his mouth off, and I just said, you know, where did you get such disrespect? Where did all this contempt come from? We've had more than our fill of the scoffing of the proud and the contempt of the arrogant. Now, you want to know the source of scoffing and the source of contempt? It's pride and arrogance. It's amazing what some of you have to face in the office. The pride and the arrogance and the contempt and scoffing that produces. And sometimes it gets a little much, Deba. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy. That's what you do when you are the recipient of the arrogance and pride that has poured out contempt and scoffing. The answer is not to fight with these people. It's useless. The answer is, have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy. Father, we come to you this morning. Many of our people are living this right now. Father, they're living it in their offices, the arrogance, the pride, the prejudice that they face. And Father, the contempt and scoffing that flows from those arrogant, proud hearts. Father, I ask in Jesus' name, have mercy on us. Lord, we come to you for mercy. We come to you for mercy. Lord, have mercy on your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's get right into worship now.
Yeah. Hello there, and welcome back to Ezekiel. Today we will be reading from chapter 28, verse 20, all the way to chapter 30, verse 19. And we have some interesting and strong and beautiful scriptures to read this morning in the book of Ezekiel. It starts off in Ezekiel 28, verse 20. The word of the Lord came to me. Oh, how many would like the word of the Lord to come to you? Yes, the word of, how does the word of God come to you, by the way? That's easy. Read your Bible, pray every day. Read our Bibles. The word of God will come to us as we read the word of God, and then he will quicken it to our spirits. There's no such thing as, oh, last night I had a dream that sister so-and-so is committing adultery. No, God is not a gossip, and God does not start sharing people's sins with us. He doesn't come to us in a dream and start talking to us like that. No, if we want the word of God, we read the word of God, and it is quickened in our spirits, and the Lord speaks to us in that way. Does God come to us in dreams and so on, in visions? Yes, but every single thing that God, you believe God said to you in that way, it has to agree with his written word. That's the most important thing, the most important thing. So don't go seeking after dreams. Go seeking after the word of God and let the Lord speak to you. So the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, that's his famous nickname for Ezekiel. And makes me wonder, does God have a nickname for me? Son of man, that's what he always called him. Set your face toward Sidon. Now, we have just recently been reading about Tyre. Tyre and Sidon were coastal cities up north of Israel, about 20 kilometers away from each other. Set your face toward Sidon and prophesy against her and say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Sidon, and I will manifest my glory in your midst. Oh, that's wonderful, right? He'll manifest his glory. Isn't that awesome? Oh, when we gather together and we are worshiping God in the sanctuary, we're just saying, Lord, manifest your glory among us. That is beautiful, right in our midst. We want the glory of God. That is so beautiful for us. But you always have to remember two J's. There are two J's in the presence of God. And the first one, in his presence is fullness of joy. But the second one, in his presence, there is also judgment. Judgment. So if you're not right with God and you suddenly have a God encounter, there is the glory of God right there. Ooh, for sure you will be on your face being convicted of your sin. And in the Old Testament, when the fire came down, the people of God shouted for joy and the enemies of God were consumed. It's not a wonderful, oh yay thing when the glory of God is manifested to a sinner. Yes. So I will manifest my glory in your midst, and they shall know that I am the Lord. They're going to know it. It is one of those famous phrases that Ezekiel always, always, always says. When I execute judgments in her and manifest my holiness in her, for I will send pestilence into her and blood into her streets, and the slain shall fall in her midst by the sword that is against her on every side. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. You heard that before, haven't you, in Ezekiel? And for the house of Israel, There shall no more a briar, there shall be no more a briar to prick or a thorn to hurt them among all their neighbors who have treated them with contempt. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. Oh, I love that phrase. And it is so often. Remember with me, where is this prophecy against? What did we just read? Son of man, set your face toward Sidon, one of the coastal towns just on the north coast above Israel. Sidon and Tyre, two sister cities. Sidon. All right. And now he's saying, for the house of Israel, there shall be no more a briar or prick to or a thorn to hurt you among all the neighbors. Remember that Baal or Baal worship had entered Israel through Jezebel. Who was Jezebel? Well, you know, she's the most wicked queen ever. Yeah, you know that, right? But Jezebel was the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. That is 1 Kings chapter 16, 31. King, what's his name? Ethbaal. He even has Baal right in his name. And his daughter Jezebel married into the kings of Israel because she was the queen of Israel. And she introduced the terrible Baal worship with her influence in that country. You know, we have to be careful who our friends are. We have to be careful who our influences are in life. So if you are, for example, watching a certain TV show and there are characters there that are not, they're just really, really anti-godly. They're the opposite of anything godly. You have to be careful because week after week, you're watching this program or maybe you've downloaded it and you're binging on it. That's going to influence you. Who are you hanging out with? Who is it that you're always FaceTiming with? Who is it who is in your immediate circle of influence? You have to be careful. But now God says this influence of Sidon, this Baal worship, it's going to be removed, this briar, this prick, this thorn. Now, verse 25, thus says the Lord God, when I gather the house of Israel from the peoples among whom they are scattered and manifest my holiness in them in the sight of the nations, then they shall dwell in their own land that I gave to my servant Jacob. You know, just a few verses ago, he's going to manifest his holiness in Sidon. But Sidon was a wicked, wicked city. And it's one of those things when the glory of God comes down, if there's wickedness, it's going to be consumed. It's going to be burned. But if it is among God's people, it's a different story. When he's going to manifest his holiness in Israel, they shall dwell in their own land, land that I gave to my servant Jacob. Hello, is God going to give you land? Is God going to give you a house and a lot? Yes, it's who he is. It's what he does. He's going to do it for you too. And they shall dwell securely in it. And they shall build houses and plant vineyards. They shall dwell securely when I execute judgments upon all their neighbors who have treated them with contempt. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. Yes, that's about 70 times that God uses that phrase within the book of Ezekiel. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. You notice that building and planting shows permanence. It shows prosperity, establishment, security. It doesn't say, then they'll rent from somebody. And then they're going to know that I've given them prosperity. God wants us to have our own place, our own house and lot, our own condo, whatever may be the case. God wants us to be able to build and to dwell there securely. And nobody can take it from us. Amen. Amen. Yeah, that's the kind of God that we have. And then we shall know that he is the Lord. In chapter 29, starting in verse 1, we have the first of seven prophecies against Egypt. So we've left Sidon. Now we've gone a little south, southwest to Egypt. In the 10th year, in the 10th month, on the 12th day of the month, the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, set your face against Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and prophesy against him and against all Egypt. So this is not just like with Sidon, prophesy against Sidon as a whole. Now we are being very specific. Yes, prophesy against Egypt, but specifically against the king of Egypt, King Pharaoh, and say, thus saith the Lord. If we're going to talk to people, we need to be able to show them in the word of God. It's why if you're counseling with somebody or you're talking to somebody about their life, maybe there's something that's going on that's not a good thing in their life, and you want to be able to show them, for example, that committing adultery is not going to be good for them, you need to be able to take them to their Bible and ask them to open their Bible to a certain scripture and read it out loud, and they will see for themselves, thus says the Lord. You can't just go to them and say, thus says the Lord, blah, blah, blah. You have to see it in the word. It's because it's not our word that means anything, right? It's the word of God. Behold, I am against you, Pharaoh, king of Egypt, that great dragon that lies in the midst of the streams that says, my Nile is my own. I made it for myself. Okay, that great dragon in other translations, it's that monster. It is really, really big in the mythology of the day, especially in Egyptian mythology all over the Middle East, about the crocodiles of the Nile, which even rhymes, the crocodiles of the Nile, and calling them monsters in the streams. But here, God is taking that very common phrase that is being spoken among the people about the monsters in the Nile, and he's actually saying Pharaoh is the monster. Pharaoh, he's calling Pharaoh a monster. Wow. If God has a name for me, I hope it's not monster. But look at verse 3 that says, my Nile is my own. I made it for myself. Hello. This reminds me of a certain other king, doesn't it? Like the king that we read about in the book of Daniel, whose name was Nebuchadnezzar. And what did he do? He stood up and surveyed this beautiful, gorgeous, huge kingdom. And he said, this is what my hands have done. We have to be careful. We have nothing that the Lord himself has not given us. God has given us. And so we give him all the glory. Well, what's going to happen to this monster, this crocodile in the Nile, this monster Pharaoh? I will put hooks in your jaws and make the fish of your stream stick to your scales. I will draw you up out of the midst of your streams with all the fish of your streams that stick to your scales, and I will cast you out into the wilderness, you and all the fish of your streams. You shall fall on the open field and not be brought together or gathered. To the beasts of the earth and to the birds of the heavens, I give you as food. Ooh, not a good end. Don't be a monster. Be a God lover. Amen. Then all the inhabitants of Egypt shall know that I am the Lord. Now, continuing with verse 6, because you have been a staff of reed to the house of Israel, when they grasped you with the hand, you broke and tore all their shoulders. And when they leaned on you, you broke and made all their loins to shake. All right, a staff of reed. When you are walking with a cane or a staff, it is supposed to be a support to you, right? Some people, as they get a little older, they walk with a staff or a cane just to give themselves a little support while walking. Just that little extra edge so that, you know, if they stumble or if they twist their foot on a stone, they will not fall. But Egypt had been offering itself as a, oh, we'll be your ally, Israel. You just give us this and this and we'll be your ally. But it turned out to be an ally that was good for nothing because it was a staff of reed. In other words, when crunch time came and they tried to rely on Egypt, it turned out that staff was not something solid at all. It was just a reed that even bends in the wind. That is nothing to hold on to and nothing to give us support. You know what? In life, we have to learn leaning on a slender reed is never a good idea. Leaning on the arms of this world is never a reliable ally. It's never a good idea. We should be leaning on the everlasting arms, those arms that are underneath us, supporting us, carrying us in this life. We can lean on God Himself, lean on those everlasting arms. Don't lean on the arm of flesh. Don't lean on a wobbly reed and think it's going to support you. Then it says, therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will bring a sword against you. All right, because, therefore, in the judgments of the Lord, this is what you see. Because you've done this, this has been happening among you, you've tolerated this, etc. Therefore, for every because, there is a therefore. Because you have loved me, says the Lord, I will. Okay, that's Psalm 91. That is a positive and beautiful because. Here, because you have been a staff of reed to the house of Israel, therefore. So this, I would say this passage we're reading, it's really, really highlighting the difference between the sinner and the saint, between those who do not know the Lord, do not rely on the Lord, and those who do, who trust in God alone. When you trust in God alone, you can never go wrong. And everybody said, amen. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will bring a sword upon you and will cut off from you both man and beast. And the land of Egypt shall be a desolation and a waste. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. 70 times in the book of Ezekiel, God says that. All right, here's another because. Because you said, the Nile is mine, I made it. Therefore, behold, I am against you. So if we learn anything from the prophets, this is one principle we need to learn. Because and therefore. You did this, okay? I. Because, therefore. Action, consequence. It's one of the reasons that our children, even from being a toddler, need to learn consequence of action. Because it's a principle. It's a principle in life. And it's definitely a principle that God lives by. Because you have loved me, says the Lord. You will call to me and I will answer you. I will be with you in trouble. That's a very nice because. And then an action and a consequence. Because you, Pharaoh, you've said, the Nile is mine and I made it. Therefore, behold, I am against you and against your streams. You know, those crocodile in the Nile. And I will make the land of Egypt an utter waste and desolation from Migdal to Syene, as far as the border of Cush. No foot of man shall pass through it, and no foot of beast shall pass through it. It shall be uninhabited 40 years. And I will make the land of Egypt a desolation in the midst of desolated countries. And her cities shall be a desolation 40 years among the cities that are laid waste. I will scatter the Egyptians among the nations and disperse them through the countries. Thus says the Lord God, at the end of 40 years, I will gather the Egyptians from the peoples among whom they were scattered, and I will restore the fortunes of Egypt and bring them back to the land of Pathros, the land of their origin, and there they shall be a lowly kingdom. It shall be the most lowly of the kingdoms, and never again exalt itself above the nations. God knows how to exalt, and God knows how to bring low. Amen. And I will make them so small that they will never again rule over the nations, and it shall never again be the reliance, that wobbly, reedy staff of the house of Israel, recalling their iniquity when they turn to them for aid. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. In the 27th year, in the first month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, made his army labor hard against Tyre. Every head was made bald and every shoulder was rubbed bare, yet neither he nor his army got anything from Tyre to pay for the labor that he had performed against her. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will give the land of Egypt to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. So this is kind of explaining this prophecy of why Egypt is going to be left desolate. All the cities and the people would be removed, because that's what kings did in that day, right? They took away the people of that land and put them somewhere else. And he, the king of Babylon, shall carry off its wealth and despoil it and plunder it, and it shall be the wages for his army. I have given him the land of Egypt as his payment for which he labored, because he worked for me, declares the Lord. On that day, I will cause a horn to spring up for the house of Israel, and I will open your lips among them. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. So Ezekiel's prophecies would be heard, and it would be clear to everybody. Chapter 30. The word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, prophesy and say, thus says the Lord, alas, wail, alas for the day is near, the day of the Lord is near. The day of the Lord usually refers to end time judgment. It will be a day of clouds, a time of doom for the nations. A sword shall come upon Egypt, and anguish shall be upon Cush. When the slain fall in Egypt, and her wealth is carried away, and her foundations are torn down, Cush and Put and Lud and all Arabia and Libya and the people of the land that is in league shall fall with them by the sword. Thus says the Lord, those who support Egypt shall fall, and her proud might shall come down. It's another principle that is still true. You stand with those God must deal with because of their sinful life. And you say, no, I have to be loyal to my friend. You know, that's my friend. We were friends since elementary. And you stand with someone who is doing wrong. When they fall, guess who's going to fall with them? You're going to fall with them. So we always have to remember loyalty, yes, loyalty to God. And you be loyal to the friends who are loyal to God. Amen? Don't be loyal to people who have turned against everything that God stands for. Because one day, when God brings them to account for their actions, if you're standing with them, it's not going to be good for you either. You're going to be the one holding on to a wobbly reed as a staff in that case, and you will fall. So your loyalty needs to be to God for your sake, for your family's sake, for your future's sake. Amen? We have to be careful who our friends are. So from Migdal to Saïd, they shall fall within her by the sword, declares the Lord God. And they shall be desolated in the midst of desolated countries, and their cities shall be in the midst of cities that are laid waste. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. When I have set fire to Egypt and all her helpers are broken, on that day, messengers shall go out from me in ships to terrify the unsuspecting people of Cush, and anguish shall come upon them on the day of Egypt's doom. For behold, it comes. Thus says the Lord God, I will put an end to the wealth of Egypt. See, people who have ill-gotten gain, people who are doing evil in the eyes of the Lord, there is an end. And judgment, behold, it comes. It is going to come. God is so patient. His timing is not always what we would expect. Oh, God, send lightning from heaven. No, that's what James and John were like, right? The sons of thunder. And God turned John into the apostle of love, right? I will put an end to the wealth of Egypt by the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. He and his people with him, the most ruthless of the nations, they shall be brought in to destroy the land, and they shall draw their swords against Egypt and fill the land with the slain. And I will dry up the Nile and will sell the land into the hand of evildoers. I will bring desolation upon the land and everything in it by the hand of foreigners. I am the Lord. I have spoken. Wow, you know, we sing, may it be to me as you have said. We sing that song based on Mary's words to the angel. Lord, may it be to me as you have said. If you're going to sing that song, make sure you are living the plan of God for your life. Amen. Live right. Get into the Word of God. Live according to the Word of God. And you will be very happy to sing that song, because all the promises of God will be yours in Christ Jesus. Verse 13, thus says the Lord God, I will destroy the idols and put an end to the images in Memphis. There shall no longer be a prince from the land of Egypt. So I will put fear in the land of Egypt. I will make Pathros a desolation and will set fire to Zoan and will execute judgment on Thebes. And I will pour out my wrath on Pelusium, the stronghold of Egypt, and I will cut off the multitude of Thebes. All of these various names of either cities in Egypt or areas of Egypt or other names for Egypt. And I will set fire to Egypt. Pelusium will be in great agony. Thebes will be breached, and Memphis shall face enemies by day. The young men of On and Pi-Beseth shall fall by the sword, and women shall go into captivity. At Tahaphnehes, the day shall be dark when I break there the yoke bars of Egypt, and her proud might shall come to an end in her. She shall be covered by a cloud. That's judgment, in other words. And her daughters shall go into captivity. Thus I will execute judgments on Egypt. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. We've learned a lot of lessons today, haven't we? God's word is full of principles that if we can just grab a hold of it, it will prosper us and it will bless us in our life. So let's learn from our Bible reading for today. Amen. Thank you for joining us for the book of Ezekiel. And right now, let's just worship the Lord a little bit more together.
Just about the time that you have the whole world figured out. That would be the time that you enter in to see. Then you understand that God loves you.
Our New Testament passage today picks up in James chapter 2. Now, James is kind of like the super practical book in the New Testament. I mean, it's getting right down there and saying, all right, now, folks, this is how you live the Christian life. He starts chapter 2, verse 1. My brothers, so he's talking to believers, all right? He's talking to believers. He said, my brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Now, what does he mean by show no partiality? He said, for if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit at my feet, have you then not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Have you not sorted the people? In other words, have you not sorted the rich from the poor because you have evil thoughts? You're thinking, you know, we can get more money from the rich person. Now, brothers and sisters, you just got to get a hold of this verse. There can't be special seating, and there can't be special services for the rich and special services for the poor. I remember years ago, I was asked to speak in a church. And they said, oh, your driver has to go to the service downstairs and you'll be preaching upstairs to everybody else. I said, why does the driver have to go downstairs? Well, that's for the drivers and the maids. I said, well, that's where I belong because I'm just a driver. And people got really mad at me. But you know what? When you grew up poor, you know what it feels like to be treated like you're poor. And in God's house, nobody gets treated that way. Now, yes, you know, people should dress properly and not sexy and not weird. And, you know, they should wear nice things. You should wear your best. And if your best is a pair of blue jeans and a t-shirt and a pair of slippers, that's fine to come to God's house, okay? But at the same time, you shouldn't be looking at what people wear and making judgments and giving them preferential treatment. Now, this is like, forgive me, this is like paid concerts, you know? All right, if you pay $10,000, you get to sit here in the front seat and meet the entertainers after the service. And I notice I call them entertainers and not ministers, because that's what they are. Now, you don't do things like that. You know, this is why I hate paid concerts. Number one, you don't pay for the gospel. And number two, it sorts God's people. People should not be treated differently because of the amount of money they have. He said, listen, you've made distinctions among yourselves. You've become judges with evil thoughts. You're thinking about how to get money from people. Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world? So God has chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him. All right, now notice, a poor person loves God. That should be all that's necessary. But there's more to it. A poor person is rich in faith, and they're heirs of the kingdom. Now, I want you just to pause on that rich in faith. I've been your pastor for over 40 years, and we all started out really poor. And you know what I noticed? Poor people know how to pray. Because we don't have money to deal with problems. We only have God to deal with problems. And I've always found that, you know what? If you need somebody to pray for you, get somebody who knows how to pray. And this is what James is saying. They're rich in faith. They have to believe God every day for their needs. These people have faith. They have to believe God every day for their healing. They can't afford the fancy doctors.
They have to believe God every day for their provision. Now, you know what? You show me a person who has to have faith in God every day, they're rich in faith. Man, I want somebody like that to pray for me. He said, but you have dishonored the poor man. Why? Because you made him, you treated him badly. You made him sit in, you know, the poor people's seats. Are not the rich ones the one who oppress you, the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you're called? Wow. Now, you know, folks, forgive me. James is not prejudiced against rich people, but he said the rich oppress and the rich drag to court. Poor people can't afford court. They just have to suffer. The rich drag you into court and the rich blaspheme. He said, now, you know what? You know, you're trying to sip these rich people, but look at how they've treated you. Look at how they treated you. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbors yourself, you're doing well. He said, now that's how you're supposed to act. But if you show partiality, now here's that word again. Partiality. If you show partiality, you are committing sin and you are convicted by the law as transgressors. All right, so if you sort people by here's the 5,000 seats, here's the 3,000 seats, here's the 2,000 seats, here's the 50 peso seats. If you sort people, if you show partiality because of money, you're committing sin. So again, look at this verse. But if you show partiality, if you treat people differently because of their money, you're committing sin, and you are convicted by the law as transgressors. Now, for most of my life, I've probably been extreme the other way. But there's a few occasions lately that I've had to realize, you know, there are people in our church that have prospered. They started with this poor, and they prospered. And, you know, because they prospered, I probably ignore them a little bit. So sometimes I try to reach out to these people and do some special things for them, simply because, you know what? Forgive me, they still don't act rich, all right? But sometimes because I'm too busy wanting to take care of the people of Roma and I'm making sure the poor people have a place in the church, I also need to make sure the people who have prospered among us also have a place. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails at one point has been accountable to all. Paul teaches us the same thing. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. And if you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. So James is trying to teach what Paul's been teaching, all right? For judgment without mercy to one who has shown no mercy, mercy triumphs over judgment. All right, so judgment without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. All right, do you want mercy? Show mercy. If you want people to show you mercy in life, sow it. And remember, mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things they need for the body, what good is that? So also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. This is what Christianity is supposed to be, all right? This is what faith really is, okay? You know, if you see somebody in need, you do something about it, okay? So if you see a need, do something. That's what Christianity is all about. Faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Someone will say, you have faith. I have works. He said, yeah, show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You know, most of my life, people have walked up to me and said, Pastor Summerall, you don't have faith. And I said, fine. But I said, why don't you walk around here and see what we've seen accomplished by the grace of God in our lives? Why don't you walk around and see? Now, show me what your faith has done, and I'll show you what my faith has done. See, at some point, there are people that are so full of their And I wouldn't even call it faith. I'd call it presumption. And they go around looking at everybody else, putting people down. You know what? Show me your faith apart from your works. I'll show you my faith by my works. Some of you, you know, people walk up to you and say, oh, you don't have faith. You don't have faith. You don't have faith. But look at what you've done with your life. Look at how many connect groups that you've opened. Look at the home that you've built for your family. Look at the seed that you've been able to sow to help preach the gospel. Ah. You believe that God is one? You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Now here's a big verse, all right? Demons believe in God. In fact, I think demons believe in God more than we do. They have seen the reality of God. They have been into the throne room of God. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see, faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. All right? Notice two key words. Faith is active with works, and faith is completed by works. As the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. James is teaching the same thing Paul does. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. You know, you got to have some. If you have faith, you have works. In the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so faith apart from works is dead. Now, two great truths there, okay? Two great truths there. Faith without works is dead. But if the spirit leaves the body is also dead. When God takes our breath away, that's literally taking our spirit away. Proverbs chapter 24. Now, this is a funny passage, all right? He said, I passed by the field of a sluggard. That's a lazy person. By the vineyard of a man lacking sense. And behold, it was overgrown with thorns, the ground was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. No maintenance. No maintenance. So a manifestation of lazy is no maintenance. You see a man who can't polish his shoes, lazy. You see a man who doesn't fix the roof of his house so that the water doesn't come in when rains come, lazy. You see a person who doesn't keep their car clean, lazy. Overgrown with thorns, covered with nettles, stone wall broken down, they did no maintenance. They just wanted to take out of something without maintaining it. Now, brothers and sisters, that's a manifestation of laziness. Those of you who own companies, you always do credit checks on people before you hire them. Maybe you should have the person also look at their house. Maybe you should walk out to their car with them after the interview if they're that level. Walk out and look at their car. Is it maintained? How often do you get your car checked? How often do you change the oil of your car? Little questions on maintenance reveal the truth of a lazy heart. Then I saw and considered it. I looked and received instruction. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. And poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. Now I want you to notice. Poverty is attracted to lazy. Poverty is a spiritual force. Want is a spiritual force. Now notice, want is like an armed man. Want will steal what you have. Now, you have to understand, poverty is a spiritual force. Want is a spiritual force. They will come upon you like robbers. They will come upon you like armed men because you're lazy. Now, please forgive me, and I know what I'm going to say is not popular, but it's not my job to be popular. It's my job to be pastor. You know, there are people that want to make fun because I teach you hard work. I teach you not to be Juan Tamad. There are people who want to teach you to work the four-hour work week. There are people that want to teach you to work, you know, you should never work more than 8 hours a day. But you know what? Can you show me an 8-hour work day in the Bible? They worked from sunrise to sunset. And the Proverbs 31 woman, even after it got dark, she's still working in her house. Now, brothers and sisters, this lockdown has made people take a lot of naps, okay? This lockdown has, I'm sorry, made sleepy people and made lazy people. Wrong habits have been created. That's part of that complacency I preached about last Sunday. There comes a point in time where you just work. You just work. You just work, okay? When Sister Bev and I were first starting out, we were traveling as evangelists, and we didn't have any bookings for like almost a month one time during the summer. And I would get up every morning, and I had a little office in this little place that we were renting. I mean, it was hollow blocks and pieces of wood, okay? And that was my library. And my desk was, you know, a card table with the legs folded out, a chair in front of it, but that's what we had. And I would get up every morning and study and write sermons, even though I had no place to preach them. Why? If you work, God will provide. Ah, if you work, God will provide. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. Poverty and want come and will steal everything that you already have. You know, notice what you already have. It takes away. Poverty takes away. Want takes away what you already have. Now, you know, you can listen to the lazy if you want and see how they end their life. Or you can look at hardworking people and see how they end their life. Ah. You see, folks, life is not a sprint. Life is a marathon. And sometimes you look at somebody who can sprint real fast and you want to be like them, but you don't realize they can't keep that up long term. Ah. Look at long-term life. Where are these people? What have they built with their life? Versus who are these people and what have they not built with their life? Now, I know that's kind of a negative thing to end on today, but I want you to notice, I saw, I considered, I looked, I received instruction. Sometimes you got to sit down and think about this truth a little bit, and let's get to work. Hard work never hurt anybody. We'll see you tonight, 7 o'clock.